concept of joy, as Lewis explains it in that book, is quite technical and specific to him. And it's this idea that there is a kind of unsatisfied longing that he experiences at various points in his life. The joy sounds like something positive, but it's at the same time also something quite painful and difficult, a stab, he calls it, a stab, a pain, a feeling of desire, a yearning, but something that cannot be satisfied in this world.
Today, we're very privileged to have Dr. Simon Horobin come onto our channel to talk about C.S. Lewis. Dr. Horobin is a leading scholar in the field of English language and literature, having written The English Language, a very short introduction at the Oxford University Press, How English Became English, An Introduction to Middle English, and way more. He's currently a professor at the University of Oxford at Magdalen College, so we're very privileged to have him talk about C.S. Lewis. Thank you very much for coming onto this channel, Dr. Simon Horobin, and let's get right into this interview. Dr. Horobin, who was C.S. Lewis?
Well, I suppose he was, like me, an Oxford English tutor at Magdalen College. But at the same time, he also became one of the most important writers and thinkers of the 20th century. He was born right at the end of the 19th century, 1898, in Northern Ireland, in Belfast, and spent much of his schooling in England, then came to Oxford as a student, then immediately had to go off to France to fight in the First World War. So he arrived in Oxford in 1917. So he then returned to Oxford to complete his undergraduate degree, which was in literae humaniores, what's known elsewhere as classical languages and literature and ancient history and philosophy. And he did his degree. And then at the end of that, he wanted really to embark on a career as an academic philosopher. In fact, his first teaching post was to fill in for his philosophy tutor at University College, who'd gone off to teach in America for a year. And so he did a year of teaching philosophy. He applied for philosophy jobs, got very close, including one at Magdalen. And then because there were no jobs he hadn't secured anything, his tutor suggested that he also do a degree in English because it was a new subject, it was growing, there were more jobs in that field. He was also already at this point, of course, extremely well read, including in the kind of medieval literature that formed the basis of the English language degree in those days. And so he was able to do the English language and literature final honours school, which is a two-year course, in just a year. And he graduated again with a first in English. It turned out to be very good advice because actually an opening at Magdalen College for a tutor in English came up just at that point, which he applied for. Because the college had already interviewed him and suggested that they had thought highly of him, but just not on that occasion, meant that he was successful and he secured the post at Magdalen. And he began his career as a tutor in English. But as I say, he was also at the same time went on to become a very influential thinker and writer, probably best known particularly in the UK as the author of the children's stories, the Narnia Chronicles, which begins with The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, and but also very well known particularly in the US as an apologist for the Christian faith. His book Mere Christianity is still one of the leading theological books in the US today. So he's sort of at one side he's an Oxford English obscure Oxford Don, as he's described at one point, but an obscure Oxford Don who in the 1940s appears on the front of Time magazine. So he became this extremely prominent, particularly religious thinker and writer.
So a lot of times when we hear C.S. Lewis, we think about his Christian stage. You've talked about his Mere Christianity. A lot of people look at the Chronicles of Narnia as a great Christian tale or a great Christian fiction. However, For those who may have heard about C.S. Lewis before, he did start off with a bit of an atheist phase, or at least he wrestled with those ideas in the past. What were some of the reasons for his atheism, and what were some of the things which made him not be a Christian at the beginning of his life?
Yeah, exactly. It's striking, isn't it, that for someone who was such a prominent Christian thinker, he actually spent much of his youth as an atheist. I think actually he probably would argue that the two are quite closely related, because for somebody who had really strongly and clearly thought through reasons for atheism, that when he then became a Christian, I think he felt he understood what it was to be an atheist. And that he therefore felt that he was a useful, or that he had a way of trying to explain to others why he had changed from one to the other. And I suppose part of the reason that he became an atheist as a young boy was at one really sort of cataclysmic moment in his childhood was the loss of his mother. She died from cancer. And he talks about that very movingly in his spiritual biography, Surprised by Joy. And he says at the time that it was devastating to him. And I think one of the things that was clearly linked to that was the fact that, you know, he knew that he should be praying for her to get better. And he did, and it didn't happen. And that I think was an important, it's not the only reason, but it was a reason why he felt that it was difficult to believe in this sort of benign providential God, because at that moment what he prayed for did not come to pass. But I think he also had this very pessimistic outlook on life that he developed, and when he was in the trenches, he wrote a series of very pessimistic poems about, you know, what he felt the state of the world and the meaninglessness of life was at that moment. I mean, it's worth pointing out that he began wanting to become a famous poet. That was really what he thought his vocation was as a young man. So this is when he was 19, and he collected together a number of those poems and published them as Spirits in Bondage when he returned from France. And that outlook, I think, very much sort of captures what it was for Lewis to be an atheist, this sense that there was nothing beyond the world. So I think that it's a combination of his upbringing and a sense that, you know, having seen what man can be like at, in a very bleak moment in history, he felt sort of that he could no longer believe in a God.
I suppose people who are interested in this channel would know our love for Dostoevsky, and also how Dostoevsky was a thinker who really wrestled with these questions of suffering and pain, and how can man carry out so much evil. And perhaps for those who are familiar with Dostoevsky, they might think about Dostoevsky's radical view of how mystery, in almost a Jobian sense, elevates the individual from a mere view of suffering to to admiration and worshipping of God. How would perhaps you would describe C.S. Lewis's wrestling with that suffering, and how later, when he became a Christian, turned back to that suffering and perhaps had a Christian outlook towards it instead of that atheistic, pessimistic stage or approach to that suffering?
Yeah. So, I mean, again, there are lots of sort of complex reasons around his conversion to Christianity, and it was a sort of drawn out and very rational procedure. But at the same time, one, you know, for Lewis, the reason and imagination were two sort of separate facets of his personality, but ones that he felt worked together critically to be able to sort of help him to understand the world. And so I think he when he describes that process of conversion, again, in Surprised by Joy, he talks about it in this very rational sense that he just came to feel that he couldn't really believe in anything else. It seemed like it was an unavoidable truth. You know, he talks about being pursued by God. He wasn't trying to become a Christian. He, in fact, quite the opposite, because he felt that if he became a Christian, he would have to give up so much of his own freedom, in terms of what he thought and how he acted. And so he, in a sense, he's trying to avoid that. But at the same time, he talks about God closing in on him. And that the final chapter of Surprised by Joy is called Checkmate. It's that sense that he's got no other moves to make. He can't avoid the inescapable truth that the God that he was so determined not to meet had actually come and confronted him. And he talks about it having to sort of at that point give in and accept. You know, he says, I'm at that point the most dejected and reluctant convert in all England. That's his conversion to theism. So not to Christianity. At that point, he's just accepting that there is a God. It took him longer to come to accept the Christian faith. And that process, again, was a combination of a very rational, but also of a very imaginative turn. So for Lewis, as we know, I'm sure come on to, stories, myths were really important ways of trying to understand the world and understand the concept of belief. And so he talks about in Surprised by Joy that when he was in his teens, he first encountered a book by George MacDonald, who was a very favorite writer of Lewis's throughout his life, called Fantasties, a kind of fairy story. And for Lewis, it was completely transformative. And one of the reasons for that, as he says, is that he felt that by reading that book, it had baptized his imagination. So it was the kind of book that he always read and was always fascinated by, these kind of romances of other worlds and of a kind of supernatural fairyland. But this one, I think, it helped him encounter the concept of holiness, the idea that there was a kind of enchanted world, which we were blind to because of our rationalism, but which actually was always out there. We just need to be able to find it and see it and understand it and appreciate it. And that's where imagination and the baptized imagination was so central, I think. And so those kinds of elements were at play for Lewis. But what also was important for him in terms of accepting the Christian faith was the influence of some of the people that he had met and come to know in Oxford. And critically, his fellow English academic, J.R.R. Tolkien, someone who had had a very similar kind of background to Lewis, similar upbringing, had come to Oxford also to study classics, but had switched to English and was now in Oxford, having done a short stint at the University of Leeds, had come back as the professor of Anglo-Saxon, and they met each other in 1926 at a meeting of the English faculty. That's pretty much, Lewis had started his job at Magdalen in 1925. So it was just as they had begun their careers together in Oxford, they met. And it turned out they realized they had an awful lot in common. They had slightly different views to the syllabus and to the way that English should be taught. Lewis was much more interested in literature, and Tolkien much more interested in language. Again, you know, for those people who've read The Lord of the Rings and the invented tongues that you meet there, we know that Tolkien was famously a philologist, someone who was interested in language. And so they had those sorts of disagreements in terms of what they thought the most important part of studying English was. But they had grown up both loving George MacDonald, William Morris, those kinds of writers, and had very similar outlooks. The major difference between them, apart from the philology, was the Christian faith. And I think that, again, was an important factor for Lewis. You know, one of the things he recognized in himself was that he was a great lover of writers like Milton, Spencer and others. But the thing that he couldn't understand is why these people were all Christians. And in fact, he found that was a hurdle for him to understand and appreciate their works, was they're all coming from this perspective. And then, of course, Tolkien the same. You know, he found at this point that someone who he had a great deal in common with and had great affection for was also a Christian coming from that same outlook. And I think that was also something that Tolkien felt as a kind of loss, gap, between the two men was that they agreed on everything else, but not this. And he was also obviously keen to try and help his friend to come to appreciate something that was so sort of central and fundamental to Tolkien's life and sort of worldview. And so there's this famous conversation that the two of them had with a third member of the English faculty, a man called Hugo Dyson, who was another friend of theirs. And the three of them, having had dinner one night at Magdalen College, went for a walk round Addison's Walk, which is around a bit, sort of big water meadow that's out at the back of the college. And while they were doing that walk, sort of 9 o'clock at night kind of time, they had this conversation about the nature of myth, which seems to have been quite fundamental to Lewis's acceptance of the faith, sort of took him over that final hurdle. That stumbling block was sort of removed through a conversation that was really about him trying to deal with an objection that he had in his own mind, that he felt that he appreciated myth, particularly Celtic myths and Norse myths, classical myths, and that he felt that the Christian story was similarly another myth, and that he didn't see any reason to believe that one over any of the others. In fact, if he could have chosen, I think he'd have gone for the Norse mythology because he just liked it more. But what Tolkien and Dyson tried to explain to him, and which is the kind of the change that he came to in the end, was that you could have myths and you could have true myths, or a true myth, rather, one that stood out above the others because the events that it described actually happened. And that's part of it for Lewis, was that the historicity of the story was one, something that he had to come confront. But I think he also felt that that didn't deny the importance of the pagan stories. So the idea of a god sacrificing himself, dying and coming back to life, that those could be suggestive stories that point towards the truth, even though they themselves are not true, and that Christianity might be a true myth that works on us in a similar way to the other stories, but with that tremendous difference that it really happened. That for Lewis was the key point, I think, was that that he could still appreciate those stories. And of course, he believed very strongly in the idea of stories as mythical stories, which could be teaching something of the truth without themselves being true. You know, he went on to write right at the end of his life, Till We Have Faces, which was a myth retold. So the Cupid and Psyche myth, sort of told in a way that was still in a pagan pre-Christian setting, but one that that clearly has implications for Christians. So stories that have a resonance beyond their own sort of literal account.
That's a very interesting discussion about how he went from atheism to theism, then finally to Christianity. Now, if we're thinking about his relationship with Tolkien, some people would be aware that Tolkien attended church at the Oratory. One of the things which I loved the most when I came to Oxford first was I'm actually attending Mass where Tolkien attended Mass. And I was just so starstruck by the fact that I was in the same building where he would potentially used to go worship. So Tolkien was a Catholic, but in some sense, where did C.S. Lewis lie on that denominational scale? Of course, he is known for mere Christianity, which is perhaps one of the farthest things you could get from Roman Catholicism on the Christian scale. But where did he lie on that scale, and how did he approach the question of different denominations?
Yes, that's right. So when I say that Tolkien wanted him to be able to share in his Christian faith, I think Tolkien was, well, he says he was sort of disappointed in a way that ultimately that Lewis, when he became a Christian, didn't become a Roman Catholic, which is, I think, ultimately what Tolkien would have liked. He says, instead of coming in through the new door, he's come back in through the old door of Ulster Protestantism. So that essentially he'd grown up as a Protestant. That was his upbringing in Belfast. And Lewis sort of reverted to that. So I think that was a disappointment for Tolkien. He was quite low church in a sense, Lewis. And he started attending, as soon as he became a theist, he started attending the college chapel at Magdalen. And also his home, his sort of parochial church in Headington, the sort of the Oxford suburb that he lived in, Holy Trinity, Headington. And he said that at the time that this was important to him as a way of what he calls flying my flag. So he wanted people to know he was a Christian and thought this was the way of demonstrating it. But he didn't have a lot of time for some of the kind of trappings of the sort of the higher church. So he famously didn't like organ music, for instance. As soon as the church, as soon as the service finished, he would jump up, get straight out the door, because he also really didn't like all the small talk that goes on at the end of church. And the sort of perpetual organizing of things he talks about, you know, how what a pain that all is. So he was quite low church. And so in that sense, they were quite different. And you're right in saying that, you know, mere Christianity is quite different in that regard. Quite deliberately so, I think. And we need to remember that mere Christianity began life as a series of radio broadcasts that were commissioned by the BBC to go out live on the radio beginning in 1941. So Britain during the Second World War, he was commissioned to give these talks as a way of introducing people to the Christian faith. So they were meant to be introductory, quite basic. And he was commissioned to do that because the head of religious broadcasting at the BBC had read his first work of apologetics, which was The Problem of Pain, which had come out in 1940. And it just happened that this man had read it and thought that this was somebody who could really communicate. He could write something that was accessible. You know, they thought about who would you commission to do this? And of course, naturally, you turn to think the Archbishop of Canterbury and people. But then I think it was a rather inspired choice to say, what about a layman who has been an atheist, as we said earlier, someone who understands what the difficulties might be in accepting Christian doctrine, and who also is a very good communicator. And so the book itself had shown that, but also it's true that Lewis, as a professional academic and lecturer, was notoriously, in fact, in Oxford, an extremely engaging speaker. Somebody who attracted large crowds to his lectures, which I'm sorry to say couldn't be said for Tolkien, who was apparently a great mumbler, and hardly anyone came to his lectures. But Tolkien people went to, sorry, Lewis people went to his lectures, and so he was known to be a good communicator. So that was the premise behind those talks, is that they were introductions to the Christian faith. You know, he started off with the basics and trying to get people to think about, you know, what are the kind of sort of the logical reasons why, you know, this right and wrong as a clue to the meaning of the universe was the title of the first one, which you know, really intended to make people think about, you know, when you say that's not fair, what do you mean? You know, what are you appealing to? What's the standard that you're invoking? You know, for a nation at war, That was quite an important kind of insight, I think, you know, to understand that that for a country to be invaded by another country, we can all agree is wrong. And so, you know, what are the standards that we're applying in that kind of judgment? And so that was how those talks began. They were intended for a very wide popular audience. And they were published as individual kind of sort of pamphlets, really. The Case for Christianity was the first of these. But then after the war, he collected them together pretty much as they appeared on the radio, just slightly more formally, and then published them as what became Mere Christianity. And the phrase itself is not one that Lewis himself invented. It goes back to a kind of 17th century writer. But, you know, pure Christianity boiled down to its absolute elements, you know, the belief that's been common to most Christians at all times, irrespective of what he himself chooses to believe. In fact, you know, he's quite clear that this is what I'm trying to do, is communicate what all Christians hold in common. So it's deliberately really trying to avoid those kinds of doctrinal differences, irrespective of denomination, he says. You know, and there's an interesting bit where he's talking about the actual becoming a Christian, and says, you know, that there's a process in which it's like going into a big house, and you might come into the hallway, and that's the process of becoming the Christian, into the hallway. Now, off the hallway, there are lots of different doors which can open up into various different rooms, and those symbolize the many churches and traditions that you might want to affiliate yourself with. But then it's up to the individual to decide which room to go into, which is the right one for them. And you need to recognize individuals make different choices, and that it's important to be tolerant. You know, when you've reached your own room, he says, be kind to those who've chosen different doors or those who are still in the hallway. So there is a real attempt to try and be tolerant, to remember that people have, you know, different preferences, different traditions. And so he's deliberately trying to avoid those kinds of doctrinal differences that which so often do lead to, you know, to difficulties. And one of the things he talks about there and elsewhere, I mean, Screwtape letters is a good example of this. You know, when you see Screwtape trying to corrupt the patient becomes a Christian. And so Screwtape is saying to his nephew Wormwood, you know, one of the things you might want to try and do to try and deal with that problem is to get him involved in one of these new fads that's associated with Christianity. You know, things like Christianity and the New Order, or Christianity and spelling reform. And these are sorts of, you know, made up ideas which are intended to stand for something real, which is the sense that someone's come up with a better, more fashionable idea or approach to Christianity. And he says, you know, what these things actually do is, what they really are is what he calls Christianity and water. They just dilute the faith. And so that I think is what the concept of mere Christianity is about. It's not diluted, it's the pure form of it.
So we've talked a bit about in mere Christianity how he has some arguments for the existence of God, or at least some arguments pointing towards Christianity. One of the arguments that one of my friend has told me to pass on the message, he's a good friend of mine at Regent's Park, he sent me to ask you about, what is C.S. Lewis's argument from desire for God, and what is C.S. Lewis's conception of desire?
Yeah, that's a really fundamental concept for Lewis, I think, because, I mean, it takes me back again to the idea of, you know, why he became a Christian, or how he conceives of that in his spiritual autobiography, Surprised by Joy. And that word joy there, I mean, that's actually a quotation from a sonnet by William Wordsworth, but the concept of joy, as Lewis explains it in that book, is quite technical and specific to him. And it's this idea that there is a kind of unsatisfied longing that he experiences at various points in his life. Something that, so joy sounds like something positive, but it's at the same time also something quite painful and difficult, a stab, he calls it, a stab, a pain, a feeling of desire, a yearning, but something that cannot be satisfied in this world. And he talks in the autobiography of these kind of key moments in his life where he's experienced that concept of joy, going right the way back to his childhood. Something that happens to him, something that he reads, you know, he talks about reading a particular poem which deals with the Norse god Balder. And he says, at that point, I was transported into the great vast northern skies, and I felt this great sense of intense longing. And what he can't understand when he's, you know, experiencing these stabs of joy at the time is what they're for, because they can't be satisfied. And what he comes to, how he comes to understand it and rationalize it later, is that the reason for this is that these desires, these longings, cannot be satisfied because they can only be satisfied in heaven. They point him beyond this world. They're like sort of signs explaining or making him conscious of the idea that there is another world. And he says, you know, we're not born with desires unless there is a satisfaction for those desires. So, you know, he says, for instance, the argument is that there's a baby that feels hungry naturally. Well, there is such a thing as food. So if we're born with a desire, and yet nothing in this world can help to satisfy that desire, he argues that the most probable explanation for that is that he was made for another world. And so the argument from desire is really that those yearnings, those longings, are pointing him to that other world. And in fact, when Surprised by Joy finishes, which is, you know, with his conversion to atheism, then Christianity. So although he wrote it in the early 50s, well, it was published in the early 50s, he started writing it in the late 40s. It really only takes him up to 1931, which is the point at which he became a Christian. And the reason for that is that it's a story about joy. And at that point, joy becomes kind of redundant in his life. You know, he says, what of joy? Well, that was what it, once I've converted to Christianity, it had served its purpose.
So does it seem like the argument for desire, just to clarify it, it seems more to be an argument for the existence of another life or another world instead of a particular argument for Christian theism? Or does he later then develop how that desire, that satisfaction of that joy, is Christianity as a religion itself?
I think the first of those is the right one, actually. And I think it's then a question of, you know, what you do with that desire once you've learned that there is, you know, something outside, something beyond, that we have to look beyond this world for an explanation and an answer. You know, I think he felt that as humans, we're often, materialism has taught us to be too easily satisfied in our own world, and that what we need is something that sort of wakes us up, jolts us out of that materialist, self-satisfied way of living, and that recognizing that joy is a way of doing that, making you think beyond this world.
That's a very interesting idea, and perhaps thinking about the different religions that one might get to if they accept the argument of joy. Perhaps we could think a bit about, or talk a bit about, the role between fiction and faith, and how fiction to Lewis may influence our lives as Christians, both from the perspective of fiction as literature in general, and also fiction as a kind of myth, which is beneficial, like the Nordic myths or other mythologies out there.
Yeah, I think, you know, that's an important component of this. And, you know, I've already suggested ways in which his reading was foundational to his faith, or to at least the process of becoming a Christian. So, you know, I mentioned the George MacDonald story, Fantasties, baptizing his imagination. I think it's striking and significant that it was through a kind of literary sort of fictional work that Lewis sort of encounters and accepts that concept. And it's certainly, you know, going back to the idea of the rational and the concept of imagination, and both of those things working in Lewis and being sort of central to his way of understanding the world. Fiction is a really important component of that. You know, and saying, we've just been talking about the argument from desire and materialism and the extent to which Lewis felt that humans really didn't sort of look enough beyond this world. I think sort of fiction and storytelling was a really important way for doing that, for exploring those ideas, and for forcing people to think about, you know, what might be beyond. And you know, Lewis did that in a number of ways, of course. You know, the first thing he wrote when he became a Christian was an allegorical story of his own kind of conversion, The Pilgrim's Regress. Notice that word regress. Obviously, this is a kind of a play on John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress, but regress, you know, he goes back to where he was originally. He goes back to his Ulster Protestantism, but you know, the fact that he produces this kind of allegorical fictional telling of his story, I think, is part of how he understands and processes and explains that that conversion story. And you mentioned Chesterton earlier, and of course Lewis was very heavily influenced by Chesterton as a writer, again as a writer who was a Christian, but who wrote works that Lewis really was very inspired by. You know, he says in Surprised by Joy, when he was in a he was wounded in the trenches and taken to a military hospital in France, and there he read a collection of essays by Chesterton, which changed his outlook. You know, still, you know, 30 odd years later, he's saying how profoundly important it was. The Everlasting Man was a book that he references numerous times. And of course, Chesterton too also talks about the importance of story as a way of understanding himself as a Christian. You know, he says in Orthodoxy, I'd always felt that life was like a story. And so if there is a story, then there must be a storyteller. And I think that, you know, that sort of must have, I think Lewis must have felt similarly in that way, that, you know, that sort of understanding was one that he would have, I think, had a lot of sympathy with. And then, of course, the late 30s and 40s, he wrote a trilogy of a cosmic trilogy of books that involved space travel, out of the silent planet, going to Mars, Perelandra on Venus, and then That Hideous Strength, a third of those, published in 1945 at the end of the war. And those, I think, again, are clearly ways in which he's tried to experiment with the idea of how you can engage with those kinds of questions about Christian faith and about the nature of the universe through using science fiction in that case. And then, of course, later on in his life, he does something similar, but with the Narnia stories, looking at sort of children's fantasy and fairy tale. And so I think the idea of storytelling is key for him, both to understanding the world. And, you know, we've already spoken about how many of the writers that he'd already known and loved as a child and as a young man turned out to be Christians. And so that was influential for him. But I think also for him, as a way of trying to communicate what he felt, he felt that, you know, there are two different ways of doing that. One is the rational argument, Mere Christianity, Miracles, 1947, probably his most philosophical work. And then also he's doing the same thing through fiction.
If you've been enjoying this video so far and have found it helpful, please like and subscribe and share it with your friends. If you want to support this channel financially and support our mission, then check out our Patreon in the link below, where you can support our channel there as well. Hope you enjoy this video, and let's carry on. He is perhaps taking a slight step back from Lewis, perhaps, and perhaps as a professor of English language or literature, how would someone as a Christian or approach religious texts or religious fictions? How do you interact with these ideas, and how should you read literature and fictions which are clearly symbolical or are clearly religious in nature?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, isn't it? So do we approach them differently? And I think probably it's true to say that with, for instance, the Narnia stories, where they're often seen as being allegorical stories, and therefore you feel as if you have to approach them either by saying, you know, I'll accept this, I'm a Christian, and therefore I can read this and appreciate it, or I'm not a Christian, in which case I find this quite limiting and uninteresting, predictable, and it's sort of sometimes seen as being a rather sinister mode of writing, because it's a way of trying to insinuate or to sort of seed ideas in people's minds without them really realizing that's what you're doing. So I think in that sense, I suspect what Lewis would say is that these aren't actually allegories in that rather narrow sense. And of course, I said earlier that he did write an allegory in The Pilgrim's Regress, and he also was very interested in that concept, the development of allegory as a way of writing, particularly about love in the Middle Ages. And he wrote, his first book was called The Allegory of Love, and it was all about the sort of medieval love poem and how that had developed using those kinds of allegorical modes. So in that sense, he's quite, you know, he knows what he's talking about when it comes to, you know, defining his work. And he says, no, the point of the Narnia stories was not to write allegory, but rather he uses the term supposal. And what he's really interested in is, what would it be like if there were really a world like Narnia, and that there was a god who chose to become incarnate in it and die and then rise again, just as the Christian story says that he did in our world. And so really what he's doing is asking that kind of question, posing himself a philosophical question, and then trying to answer it using the form of the fairy tale, which he chose because he said it was the one that was best suited to what he wanted to say, which isn't a very helpful kind of definition of what he was trying to do, but that's how he describes it. So he, I suppose, wants us to come at it without those kinds of preconceptions. Take it first and foremost as a story, rather than try and say, oh, here's an allegory, I'm going to try and work out what everything stands for, or this is an explicitly Christian allegory and I'm not a Christian, so it's of no interest to me. You know, he said one of the things he tried to do with the Narnia stories was that he was acutely conscious that as a child, when someone told him the story of the crucifixion, he knew that he was supposed to feel sad, but he didn't. And he said, in part of the problem with it was, I'd heard the story so many times. And of course, if someone tells you that you're supposed to feel sad about something, it's, you know, it sort of spoils it in a way. It's quite difficult to feel how you're supposed to feel. What he wanted to do was to tell the story in a way that stripped it of all of those associations that you get hammered into you as a Sunday school child, and say, you know, what would happen if we heard that story for the very first time? And that's what he's trying to do in The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, is say, you know, here's this character Aslan, here's what happens. And at the end of it, we've responded in a way that is, you know, much more kind of our own personal response to that particular story. So I think he wants to, although there are obviously those close kind of connections between that story and the story of, you know, of the crucifixion and the resurrection, it's a story on its own terms.
I suppose perhaps since we've touched upon the Chronicles of Narnia, I've kind of opened up Pandora's box for anyone interested in C.S. Lewis, and it could go almost basically go anywhere. What would you say are some of the inspirations behind the other ideas found in the later books, but after The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe? Are those purely focused or a representation of the Christian myth, or at least inspired by the Christian myth, or are there perhaps other inspirations and other ideas and symbols going on in those works?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting observation, because, you know, when people say that about the stories, you know, that they're just Christian allegories, I suspect they're largely talking about The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, because it's clearly the one that's most obviously has that kind of biblical connection. I mean, the others would be The Last Battle, where you do have the kind of the Christian apocalypse, you know, the end of the world, the drawing together, the tying up of Narnia, and then also The Magician's Nephew, which has the creation story. So you know you do have creation, you do have the incarnation, the crucifixion, the resurrection, and the apocalypse. But it would be difficult to go through all the other stories and identify exactly which bit of the Bible these are supposed to be representing. And the reason for that is that I suspect that they don't have that. They're never intended to be all allegorical of some part of the Bible. I mean, having said that, there is a letter that Lewis wrote, which does, you know, he got fan mail from huge numbers of especially American children throughout the 1950s, asking him various questions about the stories, which he incredibly diligently responded to personally to all of these. And you know, they include questions about, you know, what's sort of you know, what individual books are supposed to mean about particular characters, what do the letters CS stand for, those kinds of slightly trivial questions. But you know, one of the things he does in some cases is say, you know, this is what each of these books is supposed to signify. And but these are sort of Christian concepts, but they're quite loose. So for instance, if we take the Voyage of the Dawn Treader, so there you have a story where they're looking for the lost Lords of Narnia on a sea voyage on this ship, the Dawn Treader, and they go around various islands. And in the end, they make it to Aslan's country, and which is clearly intended to stand for heaven. So there is a, you know, there's a clearly a Christian dimension to it. But in that sense, you couldn't really argue that the Voyage of the Dawn Treader maps onto some particular bit of the Bible, but the concept of Aslan's country is clearly biblical. But what Lewis says about that one is that there's a kind of one of the heroes of that story is a mouse called Reepy Cheep, who is absolutely determined to make it to Aslan's country, whatever. Others are rather skeptical as to whether it would actually, if there is such a place as Aslan's country, do you really think you could actually get there by ship? And he says, I'm going, whatever. I believe it. I think you can. And in the end, he disappears off in this tiny little boat when they get to the end of the utter east. He disappears off in this little boat down sort of over the end of the world. And we don't really know what's happened to him, but it's only at the end, in the last battle, when everyone ends up, well, not everybody, but where the children end up at Aslan's country, that they're welcomed there by Reepy Cheep. He did make it. And what Lewis says about this is that that story symbolizes the desire for heaven. And that's what Reepy Cheep is about, the desire for heaven. So it has a Christian concept at its core, but the stories itself are, you know, it's the Odyssey on a ship going around different islands, having all these different adventures. It's the Voyage of St. Brendan, who does something similar in a medieval Irish work. It's a bit of Arthurian literature, the search for the Holy Grail, that's in there. There's some Milton in there in the description of the glassy sea. You know, it's full of literary allusion, but it has this Christian concept at its core. You couldn't call it an allegory, though. But that's true of all of the books, I think, is that he's, you know, Lewis was unbelievably well read. He was a literary medievalist and Renaissance specialist, but he'd read everything else as well. And he just seemed to have an incredibly retentive memory as well. He remembered it all. And it's all there when he puts pen to paper. I think he's influenced by all of these things. And, you know, Tolkien allegedly was rather disparaging about the Narnia stories because of the sort of lack of integrity and self-consistency, because it was just a hodgepodge of different mythologies and creatures coming from classical legends. So you've got the, you know, the fauns and the dryads and the naiads, and then you've got dwarves that come from Norse mythology, and you've got Father Christmas rather anachronistically turning up. He was sort of a bit sniffy about the way he did it, because of course Tolkien had a completely different understanding of what Middle Earth should be like. But you know, part of that is that for Lewis, all of this is interesting. All of these stories have something to tell, and therefore he brings them all together in this way. So I think, you know, and the fawn, Mr. Tumnus, of course, goes right back to the beginning of the concept, because he says, when he's writing about where he got the ideas from, that the very first, the beginning point of the composition process goes back to being a teenager, where he had this picture that popped into his head of a fawn standing in a snowy wood holding a set of brown paper parcels. And he had no idea where that came from. And decided when he, 30 years later in his 40s, that it might be interesting to make up a story about it. And so, it's a kind of, it's a long gestation process that involves bringing together sources that come from his own imagination, but from also from his vast reading, some of it Christian and much of it not. But he sort of harmonizes it in that interesting way.
That's a really wonderful illustration of all the different and a lot of the different ideas and inspirations that he had during his writings, especially in relation to Chronicles of Narnia. Over this interview, you've talked and raised a lot of the different books that Lewis has published over his life, and I remember a really funny part of a debate between a Dr. Holly Ordway and Dr. Michael Ward in the C.S. Lewis Society, where they're debating who was better, Tolkien or C.S. Lewis. And one of the arguments made against, I think it was against J.R. Tolkien in favor of C.S. Lewis, was that C.S. Lewis wrote so many works and so many publications. Now, if someone has listened to this interview and never read or interacted with C.S. Lewis before, they might get completely lost in, well, which book or which idea or which part of C.S. Lewis's corpus should you start off with. So, what advice would you give to someone who might want to start off with reading C.S. Lewis's work? How would they wrestle with or get started with his writings?
Well, if you've never read The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, then I would start there because it's such a great story. And I mean, I love all the Narnia stories, but I think that one is the place to begin. Don't begin with The Magician's Nephew, which sometimes it's if you look at the ordering that you get in some collections of Narnia books today, the publishers call that one number one. But it's number one in the sense that the events that it tells predate the Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe. But if you read that one first, it's just a massive spoiler. And it's clear, he wrote that one later as a kind of prequel. And it explains a lot what happens in the Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, but therefore it spoils much of the story. So begin with the Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, that sort of moment where Lucy walks through the wardrobe into Narnia. That's such a classic moment, and the narrator says, she had no more when they hear about Aslan, the children had no more knowledge of who Aslan was than you or I. But if you've already read one of the other books, then that's not true. So I'm sure that's intended to be the starting point. And as I've said, it introduces you to a lot of the key concepts that are right at the heart of who Lewis was. That moment where the children are genuinely worried that Lucy has stopped just playing a game when she's telling them she's been to Narnia and that actually there might be something wrong with her. And they go to the professor whose house they're living in and they say, we're worried that she may just sort of be losing her mind. And he says, just completely rationally, well, what are you basing this on? Why do you think that what she tells you is not true? That there's the argument from reason is right there. Why would you not trust her? Is she normally unreliable? And then Edmund, of course, who's also been there but is pretending he hasn't. What about Edmund? Is he more reliable or less reliable than her? Well, much less reliable. It forces them to think rationally about this in a way that is sort of typical of Lewis's apologetic writing. And so, again, if you're looking for a work of Christian apologetics, I think Near Christianity, as we've said, is the real classic. It's just, again, a brilliantly clear statement of what he believes and why. It again has these overlaps. It uses imagination as well as reason too. He talks about how there's a, you know, there's a, we're like, he has this brilliant way of using imagery and analogy that I think is partly why he's so successful still today. There's a clarity, there's something that appeals to people that you can understand what he means. He's talking about we're all like we're like clay sculptures in a sculptor's shop, and there's a room going round that we're going to come back to life. Just as you get at the end of The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, where the witch has been going around turning animals into stone statues, and Aslan breathes on them, and they come back to life. So that this these two are rather intimately connected. The other book that probably people don't read as much, but I think is just really great read, is Surprised by Joy, which I've mentioned a number of times. But it's a really readable book. It's his biography, so you learn a lot about him as a person, or rather, perhaps you don't. You learn a lot about his reading, and that journey, because for Lewis, that's what life was. Largely, it was reading, and it was talking about books, and it was thinking about books, and it was writing books. So, it's very interesting as a development of him as a reader and a thinker and a writer, just as it is about his own faith and how that developed. And so, it's a really interesting and well-written book, I think. So, those are probably the three that I would start with, but there's so much more, as you say.
Wonderful. I'll put links to those books in the descriptions below. So if you do want to go check them out, you could find them. I'll put them in the description below. Now, the final question for this video is that if anyone wants to perhaps go beyond C.S. Lewis and learn a bit more about Lewis from some commentaries, what would you say are some of the best books to go to learn more about Lewis from scholarly literature?
Well, probably the best sort of critical biography of Lewis is the most recent one by Alistair McGrath, who, he's a very well-known sort of theologian and has written widely on Lewis now. So he wrote that biography back in 2013, and has subsequently written a number of sort of studies of Lewis. And I think all of those are very rewarding to read. Very learned. He really understands and knows the Lewis material, and it's explained very clearly. When it comes to the Narnia stories, I think particularly worth looking at is Michael Ward's Planet Narnia, which is particularly about, he called the seven heavens in Lewis's imagination. So it's particularly about his thesis that Lewis was sort of structuring the seven Narnia stories around the medieval understanding of the cosmos. But it's also just a really richly learned and fascinating and well-written book about Narnia. So you just learn a lot about Narnia from reading that. So those are the ones I'd go to first, I think.
Wonderful. I'll also find links to that and put that in the description below. Thank you very much for coming onto this channel. It was a great privilege to talk to you about C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis, I've done a few polls on this channel about who are some of the most interesting thinkers or influential thinkers on my audience's life. And C.S. Lewis has quite frequently outperformed most of the other thinkers on this channel. So I'm sure the audience is really going to enjoy this video. Likewise, let me know what videos you want in the description below, and also what other thinkers that you want me to make similar videos on in the future. Stay safe, my friends. See you soon. Thank you for watching. God bless, and I'll see you next video. Thank you for watching, and goodbye. I'll see you in the next one.